Good morning and Happy New Year to you all. Welcome to our first service in 2021. Whether you're looking at this new year with hope or whether you're looking at it with anxiety, let us bring our thoughts and our minds to the Saviour who came to a hopeful and anxious world, a world whose hope was in things that would perish and fade, and whose anxiety were in things that really had no power over them. And they were called to look on Christ, the wisdom and power of God, and find hope in him. Let us do that this week. It's been a difficult week, especially for Elizabeth Champion, who lost her husband to COVID earlier in the week. Our prayers and thoughts go out to her and the family, Nigel and Malcolm and their families, as they grieve that loss. We grieve that loss together. Especially looking into the new year, we wonder, will it be a hopeful year or will there be more loss on the horizon? Well, when looking for light in the darkness, it's important to know what light we're looking for. And we look towards Jesus. We look towards our good and gracious King. So please join me in prayer and worship as we begin to look at how we can be a church in this very unusual age. Father God, we do lift up your name at the beginning of this year as a name above every name. Over all the losses we have suffered in 2020, we now pour in our hope that 2021, Lord, will be a year where we do see gain. Gain in maturity of faith, gain in understanding of your will and your purposes for us as individuals and as a church. And Lord, we want to see your word make a real difference in the lives of those we meet and know and in our community. So Lord, bless your church this year. Strengthen us, Lord, and be near those, especially those who are mourning and grieving, such as Elizabeth, Malcolm and Nigel and their families. And now, Lord, we turn our thoughts and our eyes to you in worship and praise. Amen.
To the King.
as we approach the new year, we'll be looking at how we can operate as a church. Tier 4 will present challenges for us meeting together, especially with the speed at which COVID is affecting people, and the safety of those who come into the building is of paramount importance. We'll let you know more when we know more, but for the time being, there are no activities taking place at the church building. Everything will be online, except this week. This week, I am taking some time off. So from the 1st of January through to the 10th, I will not be around. I will still, however, be sending out prayer chains. So please do continue to send prayer chains to my number and I will get them out to everyone. This means this week there'll be no bulletin, there will be no reflective service sheet, there's no video cast. However, there will be a prayer meeting on the 7th of January led by Judy. So thank you, Judy, in advance for that. Next Sunday, it will be a streamlined service. You won't have me coming in to welcome. We'll be coming straight into a time of worship. And then our speaker, Richard Baxter, will be bringing us God's word in this difficult time. Now, Richard spoke to us last year in January. And if you want to check out his message from last year, then please do. It was a January message. That's all I know while I was away in Indonesia. So please do tune in next Sunday for Richard Baxter from Kerry Baptist Church's message. And then the following week, we'll be back to normal. Bulletins will be out. Video cast will be out. Service sheets, Zoom prayer meeting. Everything will be back to normal in a manner of speaking. But as we look towards the future, please do continue to pray that as a church, we will find the ways in which we can adapt to the circumstances and provide support to every member. Please keep each other in your prayers. Thank you.
Let us lift up our prayers for those in our church fellowship this morning who have need of comfort and strength, particularly in this last week. Father God, we hold up before you Elizabeth. The loss of Rob will have hurt so deeply, compounded by the fact she couldn't be with him and herself having to isolate, meaning she cannot have anyone in her house supporting her. God of all comfort, comfort Elizabeth in this great time of mourning and loss. Comfort her family, her sons, Malcolm and Nigel, and their families as they also mourn the passing of their father. Father God, we pray for all those who have been struggling with COVID. For Pete and Judy's son, Joe, we thank you for his gradual recovery. We pray for continued recovery. For those who have relatives who have COVID, who are isolating or are in hospital, we lift them up to you and ask, Lord, that you will give them strength at this time. We pray for those who are alone and vulnerable, especially around this New Year time, Lord, and this Christmas season. It's been so hard for them. Lord, I pray that as they cry out, they will be aware of your presence and your love and grace in their lives, even through this time of hardship. Let us now lift up the needs of our country as we look towards the New Year and Brexit, and also the rollout of the vaccine. Father God, we realise that we are a new country in some senses. We've taken a fresh step on January the 1st away from Europe. We now set our own laws. We now go in our own direction within reason. And yet, Lord, there is still much division in our country. We are not a united kingdom. We are a divided kingdom. And we may even be divided amongst ourselves. Father God, I pray for unity. But I pray, Lord, that our unity will come with the wisdom of Christ. That, Lord, it won't just be worldly wisdom that guides this country and our leaders, but the wisdom of Christ. May Christians in government and in positions of authority display that wisdom of Christ so clearly that it contrasts the wisdom of the world, that it may be like day and night. And Lord, I pray that you will give this country the opportunity to make good steps towards true freedom and equality, not just the equality of the age or freedom to say what people want to hear, but true freedom of expression of faith, for Christian values to be again the bedrock of our society. Lord, may we as Christians pray for our leaders and ask again, Lord, that in your wisdom and in your time, you will bring all to faith in Jesus Christ. And we pray, Lord, for continued rollout of the vaccines. We thank you, Lord, for the two vaccines that are now available in this country. And we do pray, Father, that they will be effective. They will encourage people. But Lord, it will not be a placebo of security, but rather they will look for security in the God who created them and the God who sustains them. Thank you, Father God, that you sustain all of us. Please continue to sustain this nation. And with this vaccine, may your message of truth and light come also from your church. Let us pray now as a church for our outreach and our ministry into the new year, whatever shape that's going to take. Father God, we have no idea what we're going to look like when we take off these face masks and have a look at each other. We'll be fewer in number. We will have lost people we love. We'll be older. We'll be more tired from isolation, from the confusing messages of the government, the changes that have been nearly on a weekly basis. Only last week, Lord, we went up two tiers in a matter of hours. Father, we pray that we might find some consistency in our faith in Christ, and that soon we may be able to worship together again in our church building when it is safe, and we may worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, help us to rebuild what we are as a church, to carve a new vision. And Lord, though we may be bruised and pained by our losses, Father God, may we also look towards what we may gain in 2021. Lord, lead us as a church. Be with those who lead us, Lord, those who support the leadership team and the leadership team themselves. Guide us in wisdom and in truth, Lord. And may we be a light in the darkness for the new year. Lord, bless and keep all the members of this church family and our families. And may we not be shy to proclaim the good news. And though it may seem foolishness to the world, Lord, we know it is the wisdom of God. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
way to darkest night. Your spirit still is here, and though my strength fades like the light, new mercies will appear. I rest in
Our reading this morning is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and starting at verse 10. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree with one another in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly united in mind and thought. My brothers and sisters, some from Chloe's household have informed me that there are quarrels among you. What I mean is this: one of you says, I follow Paul, another, I follow Apollos, another, I follow Cephas, still another, I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I did not baptize any of you, except Crispus and Gaius, so no one can say that you were baptized in my name. Yes, I also baptized the household of Stephanus. Beyond that, I don't remember if I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom and eloquence, lest the cross be emptied of its power. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand signs and Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God, that is, our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord.
What makes us want to be divisive? Of course, someone might immediately reply, I'm not divisive, it's them over there. Many have taken up the philosophy that there is no truth except their own personal truth. And if you disagree with that, you're ostracized from any kind of civil discussion. In America recently, Joe Biden has promised the nation, that he would unite the division. After all, 70 million plus people voted for his vision of unity. Of course, 70 million plus people also voted for Donald Trump's vision of unity. You can't be truly united unless you share the same vision of unity. One would have to dominate the other. The affliction of division is not just in our world today, but also in our church gatherings. We might have a preference of leader or speaker. We might have a style of worship, whether we should use old style or new style. We might think length of message is important. Maybe we're thinking there's not enough academic stuff in the messages or in the service, or maybe not enough emotional and reflective material. We might think that a group of us are more righteous than the other group over there who sit in the corner. Of course, we might coin the phrase from Oscar Wilde's Animal Farm, we're all equal, but some are more equal than others. How do we pick through the division? How do we truly unite a people? How would that work? Will science provide that road to prosperity, or will it be a philosophy of mind your own business? A term I'm seeing more and more in social media, used by people to defend their lifestyle choices. Of course, if you truly believe in mind your own business, why are you on social media broadcasting your views? To coin the phrase, mind your own business. Now, Corinth was a very different place to the world we live in today, in many ways. But there are overtones that we might pick up that are similar to our own. There was an empire in control. Trade brought in goods as well as philosophies and religions, all of which were discussed at forum. And there were teachers vying for followers to follow their particular philosophical or leadership style path. And such behavior, such following, such vying for followers had crept into the local church family. Now we can see parallels with our own culture. There are voices and philosophy still calling out for followers. And confusion reigns now in the minds and hearts of billions as opposed to hundreds of thousands. So how do we chart a course as a church through the pitfalls of division, the pitfalls of pride? With the rising tide of self-righteous indignation, how do we possibly grow as a church? And we feel it, don't we? We're a small, maybe weak church. How do we grow? Well, our series is exploring what church is like behind the face mask. And this course through Corinthians will help us explore what church could look like as we continue into 2021. I have three headings this morning to look at this new year, but address some old attitudes. And the first is to check our attitude. To Corinthianize was basically to adopt the attitudes of the amoral and immoral culture around the world at that time. It was to develop these old attitudes and to embrace them. And we certainly come with our own Corinthianized attitudes in this world today. We are subject to the Corinthianization through celebrity, through media, through political preference, through ideological claims. We might even be Corinthianized through our own weaknesses. I'm weak, so that's it. That's what I do. This is my choice. You've got no right to judge my choice. So that's my attitude. Paul, fascinatingly enough, when he addresses the Corinthian church, he's not talking to them as the Corinthianized, but the Corinthian church. That their attitude is first and foremost based on Jesus Christ and who they believe Christ is. Look how Paul addresses the Corinthians. He could have gone in and said, I know what you're like. I know what you do. You've been arguing amongst each other. You're not wise. You've been acting immorally. his first address to this sinful group of people is, brothers and sisters, I appeal to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. The points of unity. Brother and sister, he appeals. He's the one who's the leader. He established the church there. He's the apostle, but he's the one appealing in weakness, in humility, and in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not his name, not any other leader's name, but in the name of Jesus Christ, the one who unites all believers. So no matter where our attitudes are, no matter how we approach our new year, first and foremost, we are brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ. And we are being appealed to by Paul, who himself admits he is weak. He is the worst of sinners. And yet he is called by God. To be perfectly united in mind and thought, we might think, is impossible. The only way to do it is agree that there'll be no division. To resist division, that where division comes, we find a way to work through it. There might be differences, but division is different to having a difference, if you see what I mean. The foundation of the Christian life is the person of Jesus Christ. And it's important to understand what kind of division Paul is thinking of and what division the Corinthians were aware of or not aware of. For you and me, we might have a difference of opinion, but for others, they might see division. I recall a time at college where two men, Christian men, mature men, were having a very lively and spirited argument over a difference. For them, there was no division. They were just friends having a heated debate. But for another who was observing, he saw Christians divided. In verse 11 to 12, Paul goes on to recognize and identify a problem: favoritism. Now, we don't have this problem so much in our small church about who our favourites are. But there is a tendency in all Christians to have a preference over style and personality, which is not necessarily a wrong thing. The problem is, for Paul, that there was a deeper issue going on. Rather than following Christ, they were beginning to assign themselves up to their leaders. I follow Paul. I follow Apollos. I follow Cephas, who was Peter. I follow Christ. One follows another, and another follows this one. And it was a sort of badge of honor. It was sort of like wearing those hats which emblazon a political party, or a flag which tells you which party you prefer. These schisms breach the unity that we were to maintain under Christ. And look at how Paul comes across the information. Now, we might think Chloe and Chloe's household are being a bit of a telltale. Oh, they're telling fib tales about us. But rather, Paul is saying, look, here is a concerned member of your family. And this is where I got the information from. He's being completely transparent and above board. He's not hiding anything. He's not coming at it saying, I've heard rumours. He's saying, this is a fact. There's a division amongst you. And this is who I've heard it from. But he doesn't name and shame the dividers. Rather, he appeals to them as much as he appeals to Chloe's household. It's a concern for the community. Now, in one sense, we might think they're betraying the church, but in one sense, they're not. The teachers they follow are good teachers. Paul, Apollos, Cephas, Christ. You can't argue that following these men is wrong. The betrayal comes because it betrays the spirit of unity. The attitude towards following these men came over the unity of the church of following Christ. Now, this is something we can see in all walks of life, where a particular individual captures our attention or our wonder, and we say, wow, I'm a so-and-so supporter, or I back such-and-such. Soon, our communities are divided simply because they emblazon the preferred leader or teacher on their cards, their flags, their websites, their foreheads. All in the name of freedom of speech, free world, mind your own business, I just support so-and-so. But the unity to which the community was first established, that is Christ, was betrayed and lost amid that tempest of celebrity over substance. We are called, in Paul's early words in this chapter, to have a united mind, to work through all disagreements and division, so we can lay a good foundation that is Christ Jesus. So my first point, check our attitude, check your attitude, I'll check my attitude, we'll check each other's attitudes. How do we come towards each other, the Word of God, and to Christ Jesus? Are we following the celebrity and the political agendas of our world that Corinthianize us, or are we following Christ? This brings us to our second point, our need to lay a firm foundation. Verse 13, Paul asks, is Christ divided? Surely it's okay for someone to say, I follow Christ, as they do, according to Paul. But remember, when they say, I follow Christ, they're not saying it in a good way. They're saying it in a way to put the other leaders down. I don't follow that leader or that leader. I follow Christ. I'm a law unto myself. In a way, we could compare that to men and women who say, I don't go to church because I just follow Christ myself. All churches are wrong. I'm right. Rather, are they saying, I'm not putting myself under anyone's authority? And maybe, might I humbly suggest, they're not even putting themselves under God's authority, but their own. Is Christ divided? Christ appointed apostles, teachers, leaders. Jesus appointed Paul, the worst of sinners, in Paul's own words. Paul then commissioned Apollos, taught him, trained him. But they all preach Christ. Brown writes, the unity of Christ's body is not to be cut into pieces as if it did not belong to him, the one head. Now, whether we follow a particular leader or whether we feel better self-led, the question remains, was so-and-so, your favorite leader or yourself, crucified for you? Did you establish forgiveness of sins by your own blood on the cross? Were you baptized into your own name or the name of such and such a leader? Now, the answer is interrogative, and the answer for anyone with half a sense would be, no, of course I wasn't. So what has Christ established us to be? Later, Paul outlines various tasks and responsibilities church folk are to take on within the one body, not the body at such and such an address over there who don't bother fellowshipping with others, or that group within the church family who are a little bit more equal than others, but rather all people, including leadership, are meant to be part of the one head. We come under the one head. Whose head? Christ's head. Now, I do suggest that we could experience such a wonderful, humbling experience when we consider this. That my head is not the church authority and leadership. My headship is Christ. But the church authority is to guide me to Christ. When Billy Graham was interviewed by Woody Allen, Woody Allen would keep saying to Billy Graham, so you say we should do this, this, and this. And Billy Graham, with a lovely smile and gentle voice, always replied, I don't say, God says. I don't say that we should be together in a church family, God says. I don't say what is right and wrong morally, God says. I don't say we should serve each other lovingly and self-sacrificially, God does. I don't say you need forgiveness because you're sinful, God does. Out of all our differences, out of all our divisions, we come under the same head. If we can't work out our differences in a church family, do not think running away from a church family will solve those differences. We work through them together as Christ as our head. Now, verse 14 to 17, we read that Paul didn't baptize many people. In fact, in a sort of humorous way, I read, he can't remember who he's baptized. It's almost a slap in the face for those who thought, wow, I got baptized by Paul. And Paul's like, I don't remember. I baptized a few of you, but for the most part, I don't know who I baptized. Not that baptism was not important. Baptism is important. But who you're baptized by is not as important as what you're baptized into. It might have significance to you that so-and-so baptized you, but it's not as important as who you're baptized into, the body of Christ. When Paul mentions human wisdom here, the Greek word sophia, he's referring to the silent substance of human wisdom that was popular. If we were speaking today, we might say, not in the words of celebrities and rights activists, lest the cross be emptied of its power. The cross has a wisdom that is anathema to the world's wisdom. We live in a world today of self-promotion and now self-survival, but the cross speaks of self-sacrifice for undeserving people whom God loves dearly. That is opposite to the world, which says, you're fine. You're absolutely okay to do whatever you want. You're fine who you are. Even if you don't feel fine, you're fine. And if anybody questions what you believe, tell them to mind their own business. God doesn't mind his own business. God actually steps right into the midst of our business and says, you're heading for a cliff edge, but I have the saving route. Mixing wisdom from the world empties the cross of its power. We look towards the power structures of the world rather than the cross as our source of salvation. J.R. Packer is quick to say that this doesn't condemn modern ways of teaching the gospel, but rather the substance of the gospel must stay intact. So let me end this part with asking you, who's your favorite? What's your favorite style? What's your favorite means of Christian fellowship? Alone or with others? Of course, this day and age, for 2021 and most of 2020, we didn't have a choice. We had to be by ourselves. But you still don't have to be by yourself now. If your foundation is Christ, there are groups and churches which you can connect with, where you can build up with other Christians. Find those Christian groups. Find those sources. Connect with the Christian family in some way, so that you can build each other up in unity and not fall into the trap of a worldly wisdom of self-reliance and self-wisdom. We're going to start weighing up wisdom in our next part and our final section after this brief time of worship. our third heading for this morning. Our final heading is to weigh up wisdom. Now, we know the Bible quote, most likely, get wisdom, though it cost all you have. And the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. But how do we get it? How do we mature in it? Well, I hear you say we ask God. But that maturity question is really important. You see, you can have knowledge, you can have wise sayings, but make no use of them. We learn this from, of course, Solomon the Wise, who wrote the majority of the Proverbs, but in the end of his life, failed to apply them. Wisdom involves thought, discussion, action, and the process of knowledge, reasoning it through, and acting upon it is crucial to maturity. You could almost call it a cycle. Knowledge, reasoning it through, acting upon it, and then reflecting on it. You've got new knowledge, you reason it through, you act. That's life. Now, Paul is not attacking the process of attaining wisdom. He's not even attacking Greek wisdom in that sense. But he's demonstrating a conclusion to the grounding of wisdom. Where does your wisdom start and where does your wisdom ultimately end? So in Athens, in chapter 17 of Acts, he goes to the Greeks and he acknowledges their wisdom, their thought, their discussion, their action regarding their statues, their religiosity. He understands where they're coming from. He understands where they're going, all too well, where they're going to end up. And they have a statue to the unknown God, a God that they prayed to when there was a big plague. And there was none of their regular gods were healing that plague. So they prayed to an unknown God and the plague was healed. So Paul says of this unknown God, what you don't know, I now preach to you, and it's Christ, the resurrection and the life. He applies a new thought, a fresh discussion, and a completely different application to the one the Greeks had considered, because their wisdom lacked one important factor, Jesus Christ. Friends, our world, our leadership, when we pray for wisdom, the one thing they will lack is Jesus Christ. So may our leaders who believe in Christ proclaim Christ in their wisdom. And that is what groups do when they try to engage with issues like abortion, euthanasia, and other contentious issues. The point of our wisdom is Jesus Christ. But of course, the cross is foolishness to the perishing. So there'll always be that division, that difference. We cannot be united with the world because our unity is so different. The person of Christ challenges the wisdom, the religion, and the philosophies of everyone in the world. We all have to decide what we're going to do with Jesus. Now, on a more local level, we have to decide how our faith in Christ influences our own thoughts, our own discussion, our reasoning, and our actions. Now, the wisdom of the world has become foolishness when you consider the cross and the resurrection of Christ. Either we are the foolish ones, or we recognize that the wisdom of this age has become foolish. The question we ask everybody is, what is the end result of your wisdom? What are you chasing after, and what's its end result? So as Christians, we can say, are you chasing after pastors? Are you chasing after powerful speakers, creative leaders, intellectuals? Are you chasing after your own company? Rather, should we not be chasing after the body of Christ, the vision of the church family? And if we're not seeing that in our own local church, to be commenders of it. We live in an age of confusing information on different views, and everybody's entitled to their opinion. We're called actually not to be united whatsoever, except united in divisiveness. What a great encouragement that God speaks clearly in an age of such confusion. It is often we who do not listen adequately to him. So Paul writes in these verses between 18 through to 31, start at verse 18 to 20, he talks about the fortifications of wisdom and power of the world. They're crumbling. They've got no foundation because they're built on the sands of time. which change with every fickle generation humanity has to offer. He says the message of the cross is foolishness. Why is it foolishness? It's foolishness because if you do not have a foundation of Christ, it makes no sense. But if you understand your identity in this world as one who is perishing, then suddenly the cross becomes the power of God. We need saving from the sinking sands of the futility of human wisdom. We need the power of God as our firm foundation. So weigh that up. What is your fortification of wisdom? Is it based on a hope, a vain hope? Or is it based on the truth and reality of Christ Jesus? And then verse 20. Observe also in these verses how the foolish things are the ones that God has chosen to demonstrate his wisdom through. The younger over the elder, the weaker over the stronger, the humble over the proud, Christ the baby in a manger over a baby in a palace, Christ the crucified king rather than a warrior. Paul describes these traps of human wisdom. The Greeks, they seek wisdom, the Jews seek miraculous sign, but Paul says we preach Christ crucified. That doesn't mean he only preaches Christ crucified. There's a whole gospel, but the foundation is Christ crucified. Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. And that's where we begin. What does Christ say about our life? What does Christ say about our state of mind? What does Christ say about our need? Weigh up your wisdom with the wisdom of Christ. And in the closing verses 26 to 31, Paul is speaking of the encouragement we can find in God, that he would be so gracious to choose the weak and foolish things in the world to nullify the wise and proud things in the world, namely you and me. That's the gracious, humble attitude we encounter and that we too need to begin to walk as a united church. You and I are not greater than any other because of our choices. It is God's grace that you are saved. We walk in a new world in 2021, but not because we're walking proud and tall, but because we're walking humbly and low. Old wisdom, old attitudes have no comfort or cure to the ills of the human race. Paul's words are not only a warning to the Corinthians, but a warning to us. Let us not assume our own righteousness, our own holiness, our own redemption. Let's not rely on our own body to replace the body of Christ. Let us pursue the restoration of the body of Christ as a church family together this year. Gordon Fay writes, a God derived by human wisdom is a source of pride and becomes God only for the elite and deserving. What kind of God are you worshipping at the beginning of this year? What kind of God are you seeking? We can take two things away from this letter. The first is we can see the snares that were capturing the Corinthian church, and we know how to avoid them now. The second is to ask, what snares us? What differences are there between us and the Corinthian church? What are we relying on to make sense of our existence and our world, but it's coming up short? We must first check our old attitude. Second, we must lay a firm foundation upon Jesus Christ. And third, weigh up our wisdom with the wisdom of God. We need Christ, and we need Christ within the body of Christ. Let's start there this year as we face 2021 together. Father God, I thank you that it is your word that tells us we need you. It is your word and your son that tells us that we need saving. It is your word that tells us we must be united as a church. It's your word that tells us that we should fight against division. It is your word that tells us we should be faithful to the gospel. It is your word that tells us that we are fearfully and wonderfully made in your sight. It is your word that tells us that we have a purpose and function within the church body. And it's your word that tells us that there is hope. Lord, we trust in your word this morning. And into this new year, I pray, Lord, that you will re-establish your hope in the hearts of those who are weary, tired, and feeling helpless. Grant us, Lord, the wisdom to see your purpose and your way in our lives for our church this year. In the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you this year, and I will see you in a couple of weeks.
Overcome, oh, in Jesus, oh, in Jesus, hallelujah.